It had been only 5 days since the Civil War had ended, a brutal conflict where our northern and southern states fought against each other. On this occasion, President Abraham Lincoln and his wife were attending a play at Ford's Theater in downtown Washington, D.C. The audience gave the president a standing ovation as he entered and took his seat on this Friday night, April 14, 1865. But then, at about 10:15 p.m., during the third act of the play, an actor named John Wilkes Booth, who sympathized with the South, snuck his way into the president's box and shouting,
"Revenge for the South!"
fired a bullet into the back of President Lincoln's head. Booth managed to narrowly escape out a rear door and onto a horse which was waiting for him. President Lincoln was not so fortunate. He was taken to a private home across the street and died 7 hours later.
It was one of our nation's saddest moments, and yet the police immediately had a job to do. Find the perpetrators and bring them to justice. Did Booth work alone? Clearly, he had accomplices, but who were they? Was anybody safe? Let's find out.
I can't believe that guy jumped from the balcony all the way to the stage.
Oh, he did, but in doing so, he broke the fibula in his left leg.
Ouch! Bad idea.
He and his accomplices had a lot of bad ideas.
Why? What happened next?
Well, also at 10:15 p.m., Lewis Powell and David Harold went to the home of the Secretary of State, William Seward, where he was in bed recovering from a carriage accident. Harold stayed outside to keep the horses ready to escape. Powell pretended that he had a medicine prescription for the Secretary of State, but was turned away by both a servant and the son of the secretary. Powell fought his way in anyway, and put the secretary's son into a coma by hitting him with his revolver as he ran up the stairs. Once inside his bedroom, Powell fought Seward's bodyguard, George Robinson, before stabbing Secretary Seward several times as he lay in his bed.
But they caught him, right?
No, not exactly. When Powell ran down the stairs and out of the house, he found out his accomplice.
You mean the guy who was waiting for him with the horses?
Yes, him. Well, he had already left.
Some friend he was.
However, Powell managed to escape on his own anyway and hid out for several days.
And then they caught him?
Well, we'll see. By 10:30, Harold had crossed over the Potomac River and into Maryland, where he met up with John Wilkes Booth.
The dude who shot the president, right?
Exactly. And by midnight, the two of them had arrived at a tavern owned by Mary Surratt. Now, this tavern was where Booth, Harold, and other conspirators, including George Atzerodt and John Surratt, Mary's son, had stashed guns, ammunition, and binoculars. Booth and Harold quickly collected these items and headed south towards Virginia.
When did they get caught?
Oh, patience, Stryker, patience. Mary Surratt also owned a boarding house in town, which often doubled as a meeting place for the conspirators. Police soon showed up there looking for her son and Booth, who were rumored to be friends, but neither was there. When police went to Surratt Tavern and questioned John Lloyd, the caretaker of the inn, he first denied ever meeting Booth and Harold. However, after several days of questioning by the police, he finally identified Mary Surratt and the others who had asked him to store their weapons and other belongings. Police returned to arrest Mary at the boarding house, and while they were there, you'll never guess who showed up.
Powell, the one who got left behind at the Secretary of State's house?
Yes, he knocked on the front door, wearing a disguise, and claimed to be their gutter digger.
Good timing.
Well, the police didn't buy his deception, especially since Mary said she hadn't hired anyone to clean her guns. So he was taken into custody, where the servant from Secretary Seward's house, William Bell, positively identified him as Lewis Powell, their attacker.
Criminals get caught, I'm telling ya.
Police found other items in Mary's boarding house, including a photo of John Wilkes Booth hidden in a frame behind another picture, which further linked her to the crime and the conspirators. Edmund Spangler, Samuel Arnold, Michael O'Loughlin, and George Atzerodt were arrested soon after. When questioned, Arnold revealed their original plan was to kidnap the president and hold him captive until the Union agreed to release Southern prisoners. Dr. Samuel Mudd was also arrested after alerting authorities that Booth and Harold had stopped by his house so he could set Booth's broken leg.
He was arrested for fixing a leg?
Well, he was linked to the conspiracy because police found out that he had previous meetings with Booth and because he waited so long, 24 hours to report Booth's visit the night of the assassination.
Did they ever find Booth and Harold?
It took them 12 days, but eventually a group of Union soldiers accompanied by an intelligence officer, Everton Conger, tracked Booth and Harold to a barn located just south of Port Royal, Virginia, on the farm of Richard H. Garrett. Harold surrendered, but Booth refused.
I prefer to come out and fight!
So the soldiers set fire to the barn and shot Booth as he started towards the door with a gun in his hand. He was then dragged to the front porch of the farmhouse, where he died 3 hours later.
Wow. So they had caught everyone?
Well, everyone except John Surratt Jr., Mary's son, who fled to Canada, then Europe, and finally Egypt, where he was arrested and returned to the United States for trial in 1867. He was the only conspirator not to stand trial with the other eight.
Was he convicted?
Actually, the jury was unable to reach a verdict in the case of John Surratt Jr., so he was set free.
And the others?
It was a military trial because it happened while the war was ending. It lasted 7 weeks. There were 371 witnesses. The prisoners, except for Mary Surratt and Dr. Mudd, were forced to wear canvas hoods over their heads for most of the trial. And because it was a military trial, a conviction required only a majority vote from the 9-member commission. Also, a 2/3 majority vote could give a death sentence. 7 of the prisoners were found guilty of at least one conspiracy charge. Mary Surratt, Lewis Powell, George Atzerodt, and David Harold were sentenced to be hanged. Samuel Arnold, Dr. Samuel Mudd, and Michael O'Loughlin were sentenced to hard labor for life. And Edmund Spangler was sentenced to 6 years for aiding and abetting Booth's escape at the theater. Andrew Johnson, who would become the president after Lincoln's death, approved all of the sentences, and the 4 sentenced to death were hanged on July 7, 1865. Mudd, O'Loughlin, Spangler, and Arnold were taken to Fort Jefferson in Florida. 2 years later, yellow fever hit the prison, killing O'Loughlin and the prison's doctor. So Dr. Mudd became the prison doctor. On March 1, 1869, Mudd, Spangler, and Arnold all received an 11th-hour presidential pardon from President Johnson.
And what happened to John Lloyd, the guy at the tavern who was storing the guns that assisted in Booth's getaway?
He was never charged with any crimes because the law at the time did not permit prosecutors to try a witness for conspiracy if he testified against his conspirators.
Wow. That's all I can say. There was a lot going on with this case.
Some feel that the War Department saw the case as a way to prosecute the failing Confederate Congress.
But the war was over.
Well, even though the war had ended, it was believed that the Confederate Secret Service had planned to do things like destroy public buildings and poison the public's water.
But the war ended before any of those terrorist plots happened, right?
Right. Critics have also argued that the military commission was unfair in its procedures. For example, they did not allow the prisoners to testify on their own behalf and did not allow the defense adequate time to prepare for the trial. Furthermore, the prosecution hid the original kidnapping plot from the commission so they would believe that all of the conspirators were involved in the assassination, even though several of them claimed to only have knowledge of the kidnapping plot.
Wasn't Mary Surratt also the first woman to be executed by the United States?
Yes. Yes, she was.
Another fascinating case.
From the history of our country. So what area of the law would you like to learn more about next?